Well, good morning, Mountain View. A big shout out to each and every one of you, especially those who are joining us online down in Orange. God bless each and every one of you. Thank you for being here today, joining us in our series we've been calling Overwhelmed. I said last week that when I looked at this image, overwhelmed, that word overcome came to my mind. And at that moment, I realized that for many of us, we can feel overcome by the weight of so many responsibilities. Doesn't matter here, online, we're all human beings. We can all be overcome and feel overwhelmed by the weight of responsibilities in front of us, whether it be family or work or church. And sometimes in those feelings of being overwhelmed, we feel stuck. One of the things I hate is the sound of a wheel spinning in mud or in snow, going nowhere, gaining no traction at all. Sometimes we feel like we're a spinning wheel. Now, it was 2 weeks ago when Josh and Tamika were up here, and I thought about, as they were talking about living in wholeness or living in sanitas, in wholeness, what Christ wants for us. But sometimes we can have those things going on in our mind that we feel like our mind is just spinning, 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 and we're gaining no traction at all. Maybe some of you felt like you could understand what Tamika was talking about. Maybe some of you were right there as well. Last week, we talked about that addiction to speed, the faster, the faster, the faster. And we said that we needed to practice slowing so that we could see. And as we looked at the story of Zacchaeus, we were looking back going, there are people all around us in the trees, if you will, like Zacchaeus was up in the tree, just waiting for us to slow down, hear God speak to us, and respond accordingly. Well, sometimes we recognize that that's what God wants for us to do. He wants us to learn how to slow down, because being overwhelmed, so look at the slide behind me, overwhelmed is not God's best. And I can say that with absolute conviction, because one of the disciples, John the Beloved, he said this. He says in 1 John, the epistle that he wrote, he said, in the letters he wrote, he said, for everyone, that's every one of us, you online, you in this room, everyone born of God overcomes the world. We ought to be able to memorize that and say it to ourselves every single moment of every single day. Now, those of you online, those of you here in this room right now, I can't say I know what you're going through physically, relationally, or spiritually right now, but I can say this. When you look at that scripture that should be on your screen or was there a few moments ago, that everyone born of God overcomes the world, I can say this, that everyone born of God, everyone that's in Christ by faith, whatever in your world feels stuck, appears stuck, or is literally stuck, can be overcome. That's something we should be able to stand on every moment of every day. But if we're going to be successful at that, we're going to have to take inventory of what or who we're holding on to at any given moment. We have to make sure that the things we choose to hang on to, what we choose to embrace, what we choose to believe in the times of challenge that are going to come, has the ability and the credibility to uphold us. Look at the image. To uphold us in our time of need. You see, if we're not careful, we have an adversary that absolutely hates us. One, we're the pinnacle of God's creation. God loves us for who we are. And therefore, because you're loved by God, Satan hates you. And he hates me. And so every single moment of every single day, Satan would dangle in front of you a pantheon. It's the best word I could come up with in this. A pantheon of false comforters, lesser lovers, words I used and learned in a book I was reading a couple of months ago. He would dangle in front of us false comforters and lesser lovers. And we always often grab hold of them in times of trouble and distress. And somehow, as we acquire all these things, somehow we come to believe that not only does the one with the most toys win, but the one with the most stuff overcomes. Who says that? Who actually believes that? And yet we often live like it. Sometimes it feels like we've rewritten John's words given in Scripture. Sometimes we've rewritten it to say this. I think this will go on the screen for you. And of course, I wrote this. It's not in Scripture. For everyone who shops successfully overcomes the world. Somehow the one who's acquired the most is going to be the greatest overcomer. But folks, this is where we get to that sink or swim moment. Is more really more? That's a question that every single one of us need to answer. So we think about the accumulation. That was easy to think about. It's kind of a norm in society. I mean, we all like to acquire things. We live in a culture where accumulating and acquiring is a norm. And so I'm thinking about that going, yeah, and even around Culpeper, I see these things popping up on little different parcels of land. We call it self-storage. And I thought, just how successful a business is self-storage? So this past week, I went online, looked it up, and I didn't realize this, that self-storage right here in this year right now is a $40 billion a year industry. $40 billion. And one of the quotes in one of the articles I read said this. It said, 1 in 11 Americans pays for space to store the material overflow of the American dream. What does that mean? That means there's a whole lot of collectors in this world. We like to collect and acquire. But the problem is, why do we keep doing it? Because naturally, most of us become dissatisfied with the things we've acquired. And unfortunately, it's just not stuff. It's our jobs. It's our stuff. And unfortunately, sometimes, it's even our relationships. It's probably been over 20 years ago. I can remember where I was. I can see her face. I was in a hospital room sitting. I was young in the ministry, just young period. Young in the ministry. I was in Richmond, Virginia. And I was sitting there with a woman who was physically sick. But not only was she physically sick, she was emotionally sick because of the unfaithfulness of a husband that had betrayed the marriage. And I remember sitting there at her bedside, just listening to her, letting her talk. And she looked at me and said words that maybe were familiar to some of you, but I've never heard it this way. But with a sadness in her eyes, she looked at me and said, look, she said, you may think the grass is greener on the other side of the fence, but know this, you've got to mow that grass too. I tell you what, I'll never forget the moment. It's like God took a chisel into this young man's life and just pierced it and put it right on my soul. Somehow, just those words gave me a new perspective on the yearning that we all have for more. But sometimes it gets out of whack. We want the adventure. We want the pleasure. We want the intimacy. We want the more, the more, the more, the more. But Jesus warned us, and those who would listen, to stop looking over the fence for the next best thing to come along that would surely fix, obviously, what was missing inside of us all along. And Jesus lovingly illustrated this on more than one occasion, but I want to give you one example of this. You see, in Mark's gospel, Jesus stopped in an unnamed town for several days, and he began to teach. And there it says in Mark chapter 10, verse 17, and Jesus started on his way, and a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. Now, I just want to remind you that 2 weeks ago, Josh was up here preaching and reminded us that it was a different man who came up to Jesus and fell on his knees. A whole different question was given, and honestly, a whole different outcome as well. But this individual comes up on his knees and says, good teacher, he said, what must I do? What must I do to inherit eternal life? And Matthew's gospel tells us that this was a young ruler and he was wealthy. And honestly, this was a very normal question for someone who was living under Mosaic law. So it wasn't like Jesus would have been offended by it. It was actually a legitimate question. But what I love about Jesus was, he comes along in verse 18 and says, why do you call me good? Jesus answered, no one is good except God alone. Jesus doesn't even answer his original question to begin with. He brings him back. He just ultimately wants this young man in that given moment from the first thing he said, good teacher. He wants him to look and consider for a moment the absolute goodness of God. It's something that you in this room, you could be doing right now. Those of you online, you could be doing the same thing. Ask yourself, just how good is God? Just how good is my God? Because when we do that, we would ultimately conclude that as we think about just how good God is, we would reflect on how not good we are, and suddenly we would realize that there's absolutely nothing that any of us could do to inherit eternal life. Nothing at all. But Jesus kind of lets that pass, and he meets the young man where he's at. In verse 19, he says, you know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false testimony. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother. Teacher, he declared. All these I have done since I was a boy. Now this man, honestly, give him credit. Because this young man in the law from the time of 12 would have been responsible to maintain the law. So any teenager that can go from 12 to however old he was and to maintain all those laws, give him a star on his report card. I mean, this I couldn't do it. You probably didn't do it either. But he's saying, I've done all of this. Jesus already probably knew that. And he looks at him, Jesus looked at him and said, with love, and loved him. I love this. He looked at him, not with disdain, not with disgust, not with suspicion. The Bible says he looked at him and he loved him. And one thing you lack, he said, go sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and you have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. Now remember the original question of this young man and think about the motivation behind it. Same motivation we have. We like to acquire. We want to have the newest, flashiest thing. One more arrow we can put back there and have in our little toolkit there, or tool in the toolbox, whatever analogy you want to use. And he's almost like thinking to himself, Jesus, I just accumulated a lot of stuff. I simply, to use words I've used from the book that I was reading a couple months ago, but the lesser lovers and the false comforters, like, Jesus, I just wanted another something else to love. I just want another lover to attend to. I want another possession in my collection. Lord, what must I do to inherit eternal life? The young man wanted. Think about this. Just like we like to possess. That's why we have all these self-storage units. We want to possess the kingdom. This young man wanted to possess the kingdom, but as it turned out, he wasn't ready for the kingdom to possess him. And talk about being overwhelmed. If we don't get this right, this is not about wealth and not having wealth or poor or pauper, no. But if we want to possess the things of this kingdom, but we're not ready to be possessed by the things of his kingdom, the ultimate destiny we have is called overwhelmed. Jesus told him, sell everything you've got and come follow me. This is not a sermon on prosperity. It's not a sermon on wealth. It's not about a proclamation about the accumulation of stuff that it's bad, bad, bad. No, that's not at all. But when the presence of the stuff becomes more important than his presence, then we're going to lack that one thing Jesus talked about. And ultimately, lacking that one thing is going to lead to an overwhelmed life. That we can testify to. That's the moment we feel overwhelmed. Now, Jesus' challenge exposed the barrier that could keep this young man out of the kingdom. And he may have been young and wealthy, but he was already living the overwhelmed life. Fix my mic here for a second as it pops off. Started thinking about that. He may have been young, he may have been wealthy, but he was already living that overwhelmed life. Think about it. You say, Mark, it didn't look overwhelmed to me. Looked like things were going pretty well for him. Yeah, but think about this. He was unable with everything that he had around him. He was unable to fulfill the very first commandment, which Jesus did not quote, mind you. You shall have no other gods before me. You want to avoid the overwhelming life. We can't avoid the first commandment. He had plenty. Think about it. The way I try to put it in words, he had plenty to stand on in this world. But he had nothing to stand on when he approached the next. And how many of us in this world, we acquire, we accumulate, we've got plenty of things to stand on in this world. But be very careful. Do we have what is necessary to stand on when it comes to the next? Ask yourself, has my more become the very basis of my security and my identity? For this man, there was no room to love Jesus in his heart because he was totally consumed with his more. And that happens to us so often. It was a couple of days ago. I've really been chewing on this, thinking this through. I'm driving down 29, heading home from a long day at the church, and it was in the evening, and these words crossed my mind, and I put it this way. I said, is more really more? I'm just thinking about the accumulation of stuff. And say it's bad. I just want you to think about this. Is more really more if the voices of the accumulated stuff drowns out the voice of God? calling us to partake in the riches of the kingdom of heaven. If all the voices of everything you own is drawing you away from the one that says, here, come, partake of the kingdom, partake of the true riches that are going to last for eternity. If your more is keeping that from happening, you're poorer than what you think. Jesus came to earth giving up the riches of the heavens so that you and I could become rich. Now, this is the sink or swim moment. Will we live as an overcomer or we live as overwhelmed? Think about it. Remember the scripture. Jesus said, or the John said, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. Every single one. Everyone that has the one thing. We're not lacking in that one thing. This is where we need to prioritize today. It's not about all the more. But do we have the most? Do we have the one that ultimately brings us the riches of the kingdom? You see, the more of this world can drown out the voice of believers and unbelievers alike. So I thought to myself, what about you here today? What about those of you who are joining us from Orange? What about those of you who are just simply online all over the world in different places? Where are you today? Would you define yourself as a skeptic? Maybe you would say, well, Mark, I just really don't know what I believe. I'm an unbeliever, if you want to use that term. Or you say, Mark, I believe. I believe that Jesus Christ is God's one and only Son. So you would say, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. You see, what I'm about to say really goes across all individuals and all titles. You see, the more of this world can drown out the voice of God for believers, unbelievers, and skeptics alike. See, Jesus wants you and I to experience the riches of a relationship with him. But he won't share the throne of his heart with your love for more, or my love for more. He's simply not going to do it. If you've never in faith asked God to forgive you of your sins, is it because you deem it too high a price to pay? That I might have to give up some of these other things? When in fact, you think about that, Jesus left the riches of heaven for a while. He took on flesh, lived among us, taught us the truths of God and his kingdom, only to be brutally rejected and killed on a cross. But you can't keep a good man down, and you certainly can't keep a God man down. So he overcame the grave, and he lives as an overcomer. And he stands ready to offer you and me and those of you online a completely overcoming life that is full of riches, that lasts from here until eternity. What is more in your life? Simply something you need to ask yourself. Now, on that note, I want to turn this over to Pastor Jeff in Orange as we kind of land this in a different way, sharing communion together. And I'm very excited for you down in Orange because this is your very first communion experience as a campus of Mountain View. And I'm so excited for you, Pastor Jeff. May God anoint your tongue today, and may the Holy Spirit just fill that room as we think about what truly is more important to us. Pastor Jeff, you can take it from here. For those of you online with me still, and those of you in this room, ask yourself this question. You don't need to answer it. You don't need to write it on a connection card. You don't need to send it digitally in to anybody. Just answer the question. Is there something more in your life, or is there a more in your life that has become more important than God? Every single one of us ought to be able to at least ask ourselves that honest question. Is there anything you would be unwilling to relinquish in order to receive the riches of an overcoming life? Now, you may be sitting here right now. I'm not going to presume. I'm just going to suppose for a moment. There's individuals saying, man, I just don't know about this Jesus thing, or I don't want to get too much into it because, man, I really like my life. I really like living. I want to experience adventure. I want to live. I want to have all the beauty of life. And so these things happen. This is how we feel. Now, it was just last Thursday, I'm having a devotion. My wife and I are still walking through John Eldridge's restoration year. And I pull this up, and I read it, and I start to laugh. So the Lord, are you serious? This is where I'm going. So I decided to add this. John Eldridge in the Restoration Mirror wrote the words. Not on the screen. I just want you to hear the words. He said, few understand the link between holiness. Remember, in sanitas, it's that holiness starts with wholeness. He wants to make us whole so we can walk in holiness. And said, few people really understand the link between holiness and the life we really long for, just like the rich young ruler. Some say, I don't know about this God thing. And he went on to say these words, I want life. I want love. I want beauty. I want joy. I want laughter. I want friendship. I want adventure. And so many people say, I want more, more, more. I want these things. I'm not so sure I can give those up to follow God. But he says in the devotional, these are the very things God wants to give you. But this is the phrase that I couldn't stop. I had to share with you. He said, but you cannot find life, let alone sustain it. Look at the image behind me. You can't find life, let alone sustain it, until you are restored. That's where it starts. Jesus said to the rich young ruler, one thing you lack. The one thing that would bring restoration to this man's life so that ultimately, not only would he have something to stand on as he entered into eternity, but he would ultimately have something really true to stand on while he breathed breaths in his body today. That's what God wants for you and me. Until you and I have the one thing we lack that only Jesus can offer, this is a possibility for every single one of us. The Word of God says in Luke 16:15, Jesus, talking to Pharisees, talking to religious leaders, he said to them, you are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of others. But God knows your heart. What people value highly is detestable in God's sight. That's what he says. So ask yourself, do you lack anything today? Maybe you're sitting in this room, maybe you're online. Ask yourself, do I feel financially secure and yet do I feel emotionally overwhelmed? If that's your case, you ask yourself, what am I standing on? Maybe I lack that one thing that Jesus talked about with that rich young ruler. Isn't that fabulous to think about? If you're overwhelmed and you're more and you live for the better things, you've lived for better titles, you live for better triumphs, today we decided to share communion together. Sharing the Lord's Supper, reminding yourself that these tables represent the broken body and the shed blood of Christ given for us, the more of life. As we remind ourselves that the life that overcomes the overwhelmed is found not in better titles, not in better products, not something we can store in a house and every other self-storage in Culpeper or Orange or Madison or Rappahannock or wherever you live. No. The overcoming life that overcomes the overwhelmed is found in a more and better love. That's where it's found. It's what the young ruler was missing. These tables that you see in front of you, they represent the body and the blood of Jesus shed on the cross, a life that was given to make you and me whole. It was to make you and me restored. Life in Christ, life in God overcomes the world. That's what he wanted the rich young ruler to understand. That's what he wants you to understand, and you to understand, and you online to understand. This is where we're going today. So be honest with yourself. Be honest with yourself and know that God loves you. Be quiet in a moment and know that God loves you. Ask yourself the questions before I close in prayer. Do I need to get things right with God? Am I standing on a lot of stuff in this world? I can honestly say there's one thing I lack. It's represented on these tables, a relationship with Jesus Christ. In God, in Christ, we overcome the world. And maybe there's some here, some of you online that may say this. Maybe there's some things I really need to subtract from my life. To be honest about it, there are so many things that I have, you might say, that the voices of everything I have to maintain, I don't have time for any other voices. I got my work, I got my family, and I got the voices of my stuff telling me something else I need to maintain. If that's the case, ask the Lord. Lord, Holy Spirit, if there's something I need to let go of, what is it? And how do I go about doing it? I want to be the person, I hope that's you, that when you get to the end of your life, you may say, you know what? I acquired a little bit of stuff or acquired a whole lot of stuff. And in the end, it really doesn't matter. But when Jesus spoke about the one thing I lack, I can say this for sure. I don't lack that. I have that relationship with Jesus Christ. And in the Lord, I've overcome the world. That's what he wants for you and me today. Pray with me. Gracious Father, thank you so much for this opportunity and the opportunity that we have to share in communion today. And for those that are at home, they can go and get the bread and the juice or whatever else they have and they want to participate. Lord, thank you for the opportunity of reminding us, Lord God, that this represents the one thing that so many of us lack, but yet so many people turn away from. Father, I pray today that for many who call themselves followers of Christ, that this is just a vivid reminder to all of us of the more that is ultimately found in Jesus. But for those who may have found themselves in this room or online that have said, coming into this place or checking in or logging in for the first time and saying, you know what, I would have said, I'm a skeptic, I'm an unbeliever, but if that's the case and that's the gospel, I've got a lot of stuff, but I don't have what Pastor Mark was talking about. Father, I pray you're speaking into the hearts and lives of those right now who need to know that they're missing that one thing they lack, and that's a relationship with you, oh God, through Jesus Christ. And if you're home or you're in this room, you're online, and you recognize that, don't wait for me. Don't wait for communion. Don't wait for football to start. Just pray. Lord God, I don't want to lack that any longer. I surrender my life to the one that can give me abundant and eternal life. God, forgive me of the sin in my life. I confess it to you. I renounce the ways of darkness, but as well as I understand them right now, and I'm trusting my life to Jesus Christ. I'm asking God for the capacity to learn how to walk with you from this day forward. Lord God, speak truth. Speak the truth of the gospel of transformation that's happened in the lives of those that are with sincerity of heart, proclaiming that today. I praise you and thank you in advance for lives are changing in this place. We just give you thanks, Lord God, for what you're doing and what we'll continue to do here in this service. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.